to the flag of the States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now, if you please join me and bow your heads for a word of prayer. We thank you, O Lord, for being here together tonight. We ask for your guidance and wisdom for counsel. We also want to lift up those who are in the face of Hurricane Harvey and all the rain in Texas. We want to be with those people and lift up our hearts and prayers to them, and we want to stand by our fellows there as they face peril. We ask for your blessing on everyone in the face of the storm and help them to come through this as best they can. And help us lend our hands to their needs as this goes forward. And we ask that you lessen the rain and calm the storms and be with those people through this terrible time in their lives. We thank you, and we thank you for watching over us tonight as we make our decisions. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right. Will the clerk please? Hi. Would you please notice the presence of a quorum?
Steve Hoover.
Here.
Joe Edwards.
Here.
Chuck Lehman.
Here.
Bob Horkay.
Here.
Cindy Spiljeric.
Here.
Mark King.
Here.
Jim Ake.
Here.
We do have a quorum.
Thank you. There are no changes to the agenda tonight. And so we'll move on to the approval of the minutes from our August 14th meeting. Could I have a motion, please?
So move.
I have a motion before us by Mark Keane. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I noted one thing that I think, at least for the record, should be noted. In your comments at the end of the meeting, it stated that, I don't have it in front of me, but it stated that two large fireworks displays were held in Westfield each year. And I think that should be clarified as currently two neighborhood fireworks displays.
Okay.
Rather than just two, because certainly Westfield has a major one, and then there are two additional ones that are more neighborhood outside of the cities. So I think that would be a good clarification for no confusion.
Do you have that, Kim?
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Would you care to amend your motion then, Dr. Keane, to approve the...
I'll amend it to stipulate neighborhood fireworks instead of just two fireworks.
Thank you. And then, Bob, you still second?
I still second.
All right. Any further discussion before we take a vote? All those in favor of approving the minutes as restated with the corrections, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Same sign. Minutes are approved. We have before us the claims docket. You've all had a chance to review that. I'd entertain a motion.
Motion to approve claims of August 28th.
We have a motion by Bob Horkay and a second by Cindy Spiljeric. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, if you wish to approve the claims, signify by saying aye, as stated.
Aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Claims are approved. At this time, we have no special presentations, so we'll move on to old business. Tonight before us is Ordinance 1720, Oak Manor Plan Unit Development, PUD. Ms. Howard, would you care to present?
Yes, thank you. Pam Howard with the Economic and Community Development Department. Before you this evening for adoption consideration, have an amendment to the Oak Manor Planned Unit Development District to allow for residential development. This 12.4 acre site is located on the south side of the Midland Trace Trail on both sides of Gunther Boulevard. The proposed amendment allows for the development of 67 single-family detached homes, as well as 10 attached townhome structures containing a total of 41 units. And the ordinance includes standards for development as shown on the primary plat and landscape plan. In addition to the changes made prior to the APC recommendation, which are outlined in my staff report, the petitioner has since added language which guarantees a minimum total living area for both attached and detached residential units. I do have Brian Stumpf here on behalf of the petitioner. He does not plan to make a presentation, but is available for questions, as am I if you have any from staff. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. I'd like to, can I get a motion to approve?
Motion to approve ordinance 1720, the Oak Manor PUD district.
Is there a second?
I have some questions.
I'll second.
Okay. So Chuck Lehman seconds. Is there any discussion?
On the versions I'm seeing online, the items we addressed today with the petitioner are not there.
They're not.
Meaning the livable area and not just gross total area?
The gross, this is the one that I have online, at least the red line version, where they changed living area and gross total area. Let me look at the original version. Yes, so they have added living area. It's the same place in the chart. They just changed floor area to living, as well as here in this last sentence for the attached residential. And this was uploaded after 5 o'clock today, so.
Is anyone having the same issue? The stuff that I'm pulling up online is not that. I don't know what's going on.
Well, it was posted. There was some discussion with staff, I believe, earlier about the specific language. And as Pam said, it was posted at 5 o'clock. Is that?
Yes, so there was a change posted this morning, and then there was another change that added these sections. And then after 5 o'clock, this word living used to say floor, and it was changed from gross floor area to gross living area to make it clear that it does not include the garage space. This
I'm
is
happy
the copy
with that.
That's
I
on
guess
the
it's
agenda.
Just that what I'm seeing online doesn't reflect that. I'm just trying to make sure that
yeah.
that is the specific language that's included in the signed copy that we'll do.
Yes.
So at least now we
just
have
just to be on a safe side, go ahead and make that a condition. Sure. I don't think I'm hearing anybody disagreeing with that. You're just wanting to make sure that the copy you sign has the language verified today.
Right, and we already have a motion and a second, though, so that would need to be amended.
And it would be for this version today.
Correct.
That you've seen.
Mr. Jorge, would you like to, is there any further discussion?
Yeah, let's let the, just let it ride out for a minute.
Yeah.
Okay. Have anything else?
Well, I do have one more thing, but it's probably more of a concern for the development plan issue, but we didn't talk about a construction entrance or any provisions for making a specific construction entrance, so I was hoping that we could just consider that. I know this is probably not part of the rezone for
yeah.
the actual PUD, but if we could note that, it'd be great.
Yep.
Prefer to have that on Gunther to avoid going into the neighbor entrance for the existing folks.
Yeah, we can discuss that with the developer during construction plans.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you.
I'm going to make a couple of comments. I guess I want to thank the residents of this area. This is not to demean anybody in prior PUDs or anything, but the emails that the residents sent were very specific. I never saw one cut and paste type of email. It was very thoughtful, specific. It was easy to list the concerns and just see how Brian was meeting those concerns. And I think he did a very good job with that. And Brian, I want to thank you for being responsive to a lot of those concerns that the residents had. Is it perfect? I'm sure there's some residents who would prefer to see Beezer build that whole thing out or something different, but it's certainly an improvement from the initial PUD submission, and I do think there was a lot of listening to the residents, and I do appreciate that from the developer, and I appreciate thoughtful input from the residents.
Thank you, Mark, for those remarks, and I couldn't agree more. So I appreciate everybody's input on this project.
Likewise, I appreciate the residents' comments, and I know all of their concerns have not been addressed, but I think many of them have. And the residents that I spoke with were very civil about the way they approached it, and I appreciate that. So, and I agree with Mark that this is, considering the zoning that exists today, I believe, if I were a resident there, that I would much prefer this over what I could get with today's zoning. That's just my personal opinion.
Thank you, Steve. Anyone else?
Yeah, I've got a couple of comments.
Okay.
Just kind of an overview. I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but I'd be glad to talk to anybody anytime in length about this. We've put in a lot of time on it. I attended, I think, most of the meetings. I took copious notes. I mean, I have notes from almost everybody that spoke. I listened. I tried to look at this as if it were in my backyard, because I think quite realistically all of us as counselors look at it as though it is in our backyard. The city at large is our backyard. We don't, this is not in the area that I represent, but it makes no difference. I'm just as concerned what happens in any part of the city. So those are my feelings. A couple things that were high priority to this group were a negative impact on property values. And after looking at this, I just see absolutely no way that this is going to have a negative impact on neighboring property values. I'm not in the real estate business. In the past, I've had a couple little minor developments where I put my money on the table and did some things. I just don't see where this is going to have a negative impact. We've made some significant decisions in my backyard, right where I live, that were just as emotional, just as controversial, just as whatever, and you have to make decisions based on what you have at the time. So I don't look at this as having an overall negative impact on the quality of life. I get it. I mean, I made notes that this is not what people envisioned and things happen and so forth. I do understand that. But in the overall scheme of things, I do think that when we wake up in a few years and things go forward, that it's going to be a better neighborhood and it's going to bring some good quality people to our community. And that's, I guess, at the end of the day, that's all we can hope for, is that as our city grows, that we're attracting the people that are going to make our community better, and I think that will happen. So that's kind of an overview. I know that as we massage this PUD, and I know the developer a little bit and try to watch him, and I don't think that, you know, anything was done to not do the best that we could do. So I'll kind of speak directly to him. Hey, if you mess this up, I'm coming to get you. You know, I know everything wasn't written down to perfection, okay? I get that. But I sense that, you know, you're part of our community, you know what's going on, and I think I know why you design things the way you do. And we just want this to be a good quality development for everybody. So, you know, I know you're young and part of the community, and we appreciate the fact that we're here to do to make things better. So that's where I think we are going to be. I think in the end we'll all survive it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Any other questions for the petitioner?
I just think we should be clear that the motion includes Cindy's comments of living area, just to be certain that that is part of the record and that it is in the final document.
Motion needs to be restated. So, Bob, you made the motion, please.
Well, I made the motion based on the document that I'm looking at, which includes all of what we've been discussing. So, ordinance 1720 has the specification of the gross living area as well as the total gross area correctly stated that it would not be inclusive of areas that are not habitable.
Does it say total gross living area?
The minimum gross living area for the ground level is 650 and 750 square feet. The minimum total gross living area is 1,600 and 2,000 square feet for the two different types of residences.
I mean, as long as it says living area, then we should be fine.
Yeah, and they are minimums, so they could well exceed that and end up with a little more house and value there, but they cannot be any smaller.
See the word living?
Okay.
It's not on mine, which is what I'm trying to say, but it is on yours. That's all I'm... I can only go with what I'm looking at here.
Look at mine.
I just want to know what's, what we sign our names on.
If it's not on what we sign, you can write it in.
Exactly. Just want to make sure.
All right, and Chuck, you want to second again the motion before us with the current document?
Yeah, I'm not sure that there's any, did you make a change to the motion, Bob?
No, I just kind of restated that my motion is based on what...
The current document.
At least one of us here has, is the correct document, and we'll see what comes by in written form, so...
My second stands.
I'm moving to approve what it is that we've all negotiated.
So, we have the document before us that's on our screen, the most current document. We have a motion tendered by Bob Horke, seconded by Chuck Lehman. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Jim Ake?
Yes.
Chuck Lehman?
Yes.
Bob Horke?
Yes.
Steve Hoover?
Yes.
Joe Edwards?
Yes.
Cindy Spilgeri?
Yes.
Mark King?
Yes.
Motion carries 7-0.
All right. Thank you. Moving on to new business, we have before us ordinance 17-29. This is approving the lease and pledging loan. Brian Zager is presenting. This is a council introduction tonight, and it'll be back for adoption consideration on September 11th.
Yes. Again, this is just a presentation. It's the first introduction of this ordinance. Earlier tonight, we had a joint meeting with the Redevelopment Authority and the Redevelopment Commission, and they adopted resolutions approving the same. Keeping in mind that you have the opportunity to say yes or no to future financing by the Redevelopment Authority and the Commission. This particular approving lease and pledging LOIT ordinance is to relieve the debt of the bands bond anticipation notes that'll be fully mature in April of 2018. Doing so now, we believe, will give us a lower rate overall, and this would be required, absolutely required, to be done in April. So we're a little ahead of the game. I have a couple of my partners here. Jim Crawford, is he still here? Yeah. Crawford's here, and he's with Catherine Finelli, who I don't know if you've met before, but she does a lot of this type of work and was involved in this and has a resume that includes elected office, so that's kind of a rare thing. If you have any questions, please feel free to send them to me over the week, and I'll make sure you get your answers as quickly as I can, so this will be ready to be adopted in 2 weeks. Any pressing questions can, of course, be...
I have a couple of questions. I'm going to make assumptions. This is a refinancing, so therefore it's not extending the term of the bond, but it's just refinancing the principal of the bond because of lower interest rates?
Not exactly. What we did is we took out bands, bond anticipation notes, which are good for no more than 5 years, in anticipating a bond to replace those, and that's exactly what we're doing here. So in a way, yes, it's refinancing those bands but it's also required to be done because you can't extend the bans.
Okay, and the bonds themselves fall under the tax cap, so therefore homeowners would not see any impact on their taxes because of tax caps?
No, it's not property tax based. It's basing LOIT on it, however.
We have a LOIT?
Jim, do you want to explain how this is formulated for them?
It's the new COIT.
Pardon me?
It's the new COIT.
It's the new COIT. It's the new COIT. So COIT is not called LOIT.
LOIT is the old COIT.
Okay, then you don't need to explain.
No, not a new LOIT.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just a renaming of the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Counselor, while Mr. Crawford is on his feet, I let him get down. He got way too quick. I'm somewhat relieved that there's no new money in this. I've already mentioned this to you before, that the, you know, my comfort level is that RDCs and RDAs normally operate off of income they generate off of their projects. Now, the new thing seems to be they can dip into another well of COIT or LOIT or whatever you want to call it to make things go. But I want to be assured that there will be competitive bids for this $27 million, because we're saying, okay, here's $27 million. We ought to get the very best rate we can. And if we're the very best, we ought to get the very best rate. And I know we've put 5% in there as a top, but we ought to get quite a bit better than that. And I would hope that we would.
Well, I'll,
can
I'll,
you explain that process
for,
to me?
Jim Crawford, partner with Craig Duvall, we're serving as bond counsel on the project. Sometimes you get a better rate on competitive bid. Sometimes you get a better rate on a private negotiated placement. Stifel and Nicholas and Company is the successor to City Securities. Is advising the city as well as O.W. Crone when the time comes to sell the bonds as to which way would be better. The approvals would allow either. It's anticipated that the rate will be substantially lower than 5%. There's currently an offer on the table for a forward rate lock at 3.65% for 25-year money. And the reason we're going through this process now is if that appears to be the better route to go, the determination is going to have to be made this fall rather than next spring on that. And so the numbers will be run, and we anticipate that the rate being, you know, another, being a full point and, you know, 45 basis points lower than what that 5% is. That's always in there just as a maximum.
How will we be rated on these? Is there a rating that we must go through?
There won't be any rating. These are not payable from property taxes. The bond documents and the lease itself indicate that there's a pledge of LOIT and other legally available revenues. The plan is that as the TIF increment from the facility increases, that will be used in place of the LOIT and ultimately completely replace the LOIT.
If you remember, I'm old enough to remember, I suffered my 77th birthday the other day, that LOIT or COIT was a replacement for property tax under Otis Bowen, who was governor at that time. And although it says we're not dipping into general obligation money, in reality, we kind of are. When we pledge LOIT, now I know we've seemed to have had enough money in the TIF income to pay this, but, you know, if times got real tough, we would have to dip into that. That's basically the way it's proposed.
And O.W. Crone is running the analysis. At the time, the bonds in 2016, August, were issued to take out the 2011-2012 temporary financings. There was 496% coverage. With this, the coverage will still be north of 2.5 times what the coverage is without putting any TIF money to that. And the COIT, now LOIT statute, now specifically says that economic development incentives and projects is a permitted and encouraged encourage use of the of the Lowit money. And I just turned 70 a couple of weeks ago, so I remember Doc Bowen well and a fantastic governor.
I had to ask.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Just as a point of interest, I agree with Joe over the concerns, but note that we're doing this a little ahead of the curve just to get a lower rate. That's the whole impetus of doing this. Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay. This will be back for us at our next council meeting. At this time, residents who wish to address the council on items not on the agenda may do so. Anybody care to address the council? Thank you. Do we have an APC report tonight?
We do. APC met last Monday evening. We approved the overall development plan and the site plan for Village Park Plaza amendment there on 146th Street. We also sent the Oak Manor PUD district amendment to this body with a positive recommendation. We acted on a consent agenda item of a detailed development plan for the Village Park Plaza as well. That was it.
Right, thank
Early
you.
Short meeting.
Any other council comments tonight? The mayor is out of town today, so we will not hear from him tonight. This time, if there's no other business before us, I'd ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion to adjourn and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. We stand adjourned. Thank you.